we speak of God's wisdom, secret and hidden, which God decreed before the ages for our glory. None of the rulers of this age understood this, for if they had, they would not have crucified the Lord of glory. But as it is written, no eye has seen, nor ear heard, nor the human heart conceived, what God has prepared for those who love Him. These things God has revealed to us through the Holy Spirit, and for the Spirit searches everything, even the depths of God.
Yeah. them and hear what he is saying. It is very much embedded in their mind who God is and what the scriptures say in the Old Testament and how to follow it. And now he's coming along and asking them to modify some of the things they believe. He's not attacking it, but he is modifying, he's fulfilling it. And that is a very difficult process to sort through. It's very much like raising a child, that the laws and the commands and the way that you handle a young child is very different than the way you hope to be able to handle your children as they get older. They have to have different commands. They have to have a different kind of understanding about life, that they cannot reason it all out. In the Old Testament, he's trying to shape them and form them so that they would be receptive to the gospel, to what Jesus has to say. And he's saying, I'm not coming up with my own stuff, but this is what the Father has sent me into the world to teach you. So he's trying to bridge that gap. The reason why I think that's very powerful, because even though that's dealing with the Old Testament and turning into the New Testament, by our very nature, we still try to live by the Old Testament. Because we can't escape from our need to have rules and regulations and commandments. If we don't have internal commandments, then we will allow other people to treat us any way they want. If we have a deep love for ourselves and confidence in ourselves, we won't let another person take advantage of us. Because we're not petrified of not being loved, we're not afraid if the other person rejects us. We realize that there are certain behaviors that if they do this, our life can be miserable. And there are many torturous, miserable people because they did not pay attention to the type of commands that are necessary in order to have a healthy relationship. It's not just pertaining to people who are planning on getting married, but it's also true for parents. You ask any teacher, in a very short length of time, they can figure out what the home life is and how the parents are raising the children. Whether or not they're spending enough time with them, whether or not they're giving them enough guidance, and most important, whether or not they're given a good witness to what it means to be emotionally healthy and having healthy choices in the way they live their life. You can tell whether they're being kept clean, whether or not their mind is developing empathy for the other person, or going to be growing up into being a very prejudiced and very judgmental and hate-filled person. It is very, very hard to understand that in all things we have to have inner commands. Things that we will not do because we know what harm it will cause those people that we love. And those commands within ourselves that doesn't allow other people to handle us and treat us in a way that can destroy us. And again, going back to the relationship with children growing up, sometimes they don't have the power in order to make those decisions. They rely on the values and the commitments and the morals of adults, mainly their parents. You can't be a self-centered person without some kind of anchor of what's right and what's wrong, and to think that you can also be a good spouse, and a good friend, and a good parent, or even a good child. So it makes perfect sense that Jesus is laying out this foundation world, you would think, would jump at the chance of having a Savior that loves us unconditionally and died for us and is a healer. But it's not true. Without the right foundation, it cannot grow. I think of that every time I say liturgy, when we do the Lord brings loaves and majesty, that where the seed, the divine word of God, takes root in fertile ground. It's why in Catholic faith we believe that Mary is immaculate, so that the ground that the seed took root would be absolutely fertile, and so that it can grow. And we're never done, in a sense, moving from the deep understanding of the commandments within us and moving into the area of grace. Because there is also the truth in the fact that you can do everything right. But that doesn't mean that your child or your spouse or your parents and most importantly ourselves can do the exact right thing every single time. He knows that we're broken. He knows that we're wounded. He knows we've been hurt in a variety of ways, and we are struggling. And we can still use that same structure, moving from the intercommandments to living by grace. It's not a free-for-all. All things are permissible, but it's understanding that love thrives when it's in fertile ground, when it has its structure. And Jesus is now in the ministry of providing us with that grace. That what we cannot conquer and what we cannot handle simply by those inner commands, it doesn't mean you abandon them. But it does mean that in life, if you will not forgive, if you will not develop empathy for the other person, if you cannot see that we could never correct the errors of the past by types of revenge and payback, then we can never have peace. The only way there can be peace in our heart and peace around us is that we have respect for these commands. But most importantly, that we don't allow them to destroy us. That sometimes we have to let go and understand what our weaknesses are. That if we know we tend to overreact to a certain situation, we have to keep that in mind and try to avoid it. Or practice. You know, I myself say I have to stack the deck to make sure I have the right cards in there. I can't pretend that just by intellectually thinking it out that I will be able to give the response that's the most fruitful. Something has to change deeper than in the mind. It has to change somewhere in the heart. That we have this commandment that's guarding that area so that we can act by grace. That we can't jeopardize our role in life. That I think by the time we reach the ripe old age of 39, just covering everything with that. There's nobody over 39 in here, that's why I have to use that. That we're bound to have been wounded in such a way that we become completely convinced that we're only going on because of the grace and the mercy of God. And I think every single liturgy is a time to look at that part in our life that needs another dose of mercy. And be reminded that over and over again, to hand it over. And if you are absolutely 100% 100% perfect, and most of you are. You can pray for the person that's, I won't say close to you, but somewhere in here, that might need your prayers so that they can become as perfect as you. Or me. You've got a lot of praying to do. Which isn't bad. I don't know if I'm bad at being good or good at being bad. But to be understanding that we don't have to give up. There is a way out. The world has all kinds of suggestions to deal with the turmoil and frustrations in our life and our unhappiness. But there is the Word of the Father made flesh. His name is Jesus, and he sent an advocate, the Holy Spirit. The way of peace is the way that we discover all those beautiful structures of prayer within our liturgy. Hand them over and let him replace it with compassion and mercy. offerings of our ancestors, and I accept these offerings that your children brought to you out of the love of you in your holy name. Shower your spiritual blessings upon them, and in place of their earthly gifts, grant them life in your kingdom. As we remember our Lord God and Savior Jesus Christ and his plan of salvation for us, we call upon his offering all those who please God from heaven to this day. Especially Mary, the Blessed Mother God, Saint Mary. We now remember and sacrifice all the holy churches and the shepherds of the true faith, especially Francis the Pope of Rome, Bishop Peter of Canterbury, Grand Diocesan, our Bishop Gregory Brown, and all bishops. With them, remember the priests and deacons and all who serve the church. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace and stability of the whole world, for a blessed and prosperous year, for an abundant harvest, for the sick and the oppressed, for all who call upon your holy name on land, at sea, or in the air, and who profess that you are the true God, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Remember those who have presented the offerings upon this altar, and those who desire to do so upon our name, and grant them their petitions. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
We pray for all those who daily struggle with chronic illness, anxiety, and pain in their lives, that they will find healing and comfort in the Lord. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
We pray for peace throughout the world, especially in the Middle East and Africa, and an end to war and all acts of violence and hatred. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
We remember all the saints, fathers, prophets, apostles, martyrs, and confessors, Mary, the Mother of God, St. Joseph, St. Jude, and St. Mary, and all the righteous and the just, who their prayers make us worthy to stand among them. We pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Remember, O Lord, in grace, those who have left us and have gone to you, especially, all in our name. For the first Christian disciples to this day, they were signed with the seal of baptism and received the precious body and blood of your Son. They wait for you in life-giving hope. Raise them up on the last day, and in your mercy forgive their sins. For our Lord God and Savior Jesus Christ, who is without sin, we hope to find mercy and forgiveness for our sins and for theirs.
For the rest of our life in the Bible. And forgive the sins we have committed, with or without our knowledge.
Grant us pardon, God, and forgive us and depart, so that your blessed name may be glorified in us in all things. With the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, and that of your living Holy Spirit, now and forever.
As it was, is now, and shall be forever.
Trespass against us, and lead us not into temptation.
Gracious God and Father, how can we thank you for your goodness?
Thank you. I made it. That was the main thing going on.